Okay. Welcome to the Bridgerton Season 3 Global Fan Event. We're thrilled to have fans from all around the world joining us in conversation with the cast, executive producer Shonda Rhimes, showrunner Jess Brownell, and author Julia Quinn to talk about pollen season and updates around the ton. Please, as a reminder, no filming or pictures to be taken during the panel. Without further ado, please welcome to the stage Shonda Rhimes, Jess Brownell, and Julia Quinn.
Hello.
Looking fabulous, looking fabulous. Hello, how are you all? Nice to see you too. So everyone has been anxiously awaiting this season, the season of pollen. The fans are clearly excited, but what most excites you about this new season and new romance? I'll start with you, Shonda.
I think what I'm most excited about for the fans and for everybody is that usually we're meeting a new person who's falling in love with one of our regulars. This time, we know the people who are falling in love. We're already rooting for them because we already know them, and I'm excited for that.
And what about yourself, Jess?
I think also Colin and Penelope are underdogs in many ways. You know, you have Penelope, who's the perennial wallflower, and you have Colin, who's the third son who hasn't quite found himself. And we get to see these characters step into their power this year, which I think will be, you know, make a lot of people who've ever had an unrequited crush or feel like an underdog before feel very seen.
I was just going to add on a little bit to what Shonda said to take you back to the writing of the book that it was based on, Romancing Mr. Bridgerton. And this was actually the hardest book that I've ever had to plot because there were two characters who were so well established. And usually when you bring in a second one, you can be like, oh, I can make this person whatever I need for the story, but I already had these two people who were set. And so that's why I think it worked so well to do a friends to lovers story. And I'm kind of excited for that because I feel like we don't see that quite so much on television. And having seen a little peek myself, I can tell you it's done really, really well.
So this is a brand new season, and we have a brand new showrunner, Jess, who's been involved with Bridgerton for some time and is now taking on a bigger role. Shonda, you and Jess have worked together for a while, is that correct?
Oh my gosh, we've worked together for so long.
15. You?
15 years, yeah. Jess was my producing partner's assistant when she started. I always like to say, it could happen to you. You work hard, you make it up. But Jess has been amazing, and she's been a writer on Scandal. Yeah.
Inventing Anna.
Yeah, we've worked a lot.
Jess, how does it feel to take the reins of this phenomenal series? And did you have immediate thoughts on how you wanted to differentiate this season from the first two seasons of Bridgerton?
Sure. Terrifying at first, stepping in. You know, big responsibility, but also a huge privilege. I think the fact that so many people love the show is really rewarding. And I'm surrounded by incredible support from Shonda and everyone at Shondaland. I have been with the show from the beginning, and I really believe in the vision that, you know, Shonda and Chris and obviously Julia have for the show. And so I'm not changing anything too drastically. But that being said, you know, every season, because we focus on a different couple, it's a slightly different tone. And Friends to Lovers allows a little bit more familiarity, a little bit more coziness, and it allows us to lean into classic rom-com tropes. So we're playing with those tropes, we're turning them on their head in some cases, and there's a lot of awkward banter, which I personally love writing.
Shonda and Jess, could you recap where we left off in season two and where we begin in season three?
Wow, that's hard. It's hard because we are finished with season three and we're starting with season four at this point. When we left off, we'd found out that Penelope was Lady Whistledown, at least Eloise had found out, and that was a big deal. And she'd just been sort of insulted, Penelope had, by Colin.
Yeah, and, you know, Colin, for his part, I think he spent last season trying to find himself and get over past heartbreaks. He enters this season having succeeded at that. He enters with a real new sense of confidence, and that's a good thing because Penelope has lost her two best friends in the world. She's trying to, you know, make the best of a bad situation, and she's going to need some help from Colin.
Julia, book fans are so excited for this particular book to be adapted. Were there specific moments from Romancing Mr. Bridgerton that you really hoped would be included and that fans could look forward to seeing on screen?
Well, there are lots of moments, but one that comes to mind is kind of towards the beginning of the book, Colin cuts his hand. And in the book, you know, Penelope is helping to, you know, wrap it up, put pressure on it, that sort of thing. And it's kind of their first true moment of intimacy, like kind of emotionally, but also like, you know, even like touching somebody's hand in Regency times was really quite risque. And yeah, and it is indeed in the show, so.
Shonda and Jess, would you tease for us some of the most exciting elements we can look forward to this season? So I'm thinking new characters, returning favorites, friendships breaking, or perhaps mending?
I think we get to see a lot of our characters in new situations for themselves and things that would never have been possible for them, say, last season. So I think we're seeing some of that, and that's exciting. And we do have some very interesting new characters.
Do we maybe have the hand wrap moment to show audiences?
I think we do.
Ooh, let's do that. It's a sneak peek photo.
Is there anything else that you can reveal about the season before we bring out our cast? I know I'm asking for a lot.
Well, I really can't reveal that much, but I could give you the episode titles if you want.
Give them to me.
Okay. Love them. Okay, I have to do these from memory. So episode one, we've got Out of the Shadows. Episode two is How Bright the Moon. Three is Forces of Nature. Four is Old Friends. Five is TikTok, like a clock, not like the app. There's no TikTok dancing, only behind the scenes. Six will be Romancing Mr. Bridgerton. We always do our nod to Julia. Seven is Joining of Hands. And eight will be Into the Light. So take what guesses you can from those titles. Maybe you can have some theories.
I love Out of Shadows and then Into the Light.
Yeah.
That's good.
Well, now that we've heard a little bit about your vision of the season, let's bring out the cast to learn more about what's in store.
Well, that's exciting.
It's very exciting. Welcome our cast!
Is the queen, so she is.
Yes. You all look, welcome everyone. Very exciting to see you all.
Hello, hello.
Very, very great. So I have a rapid fire question for all of you. If you had one word to describe the season, what would it be? Okay, I'm going to start with you, Shonda.
Oh, I found it intimate. I think that's my favorite word. It's intimate.
Good word. Jess?
I'm going with confidence in many ways. Interpret as you will.
Yeah, mysterious. Julia?
I'm here for the fans, so I'm going to say long-awaited.
I'm going to go, it sounds obvious, but romantic.
I'm going to go unpredictable.
Ooh. Martin, what about you?
I'm going to go with warm.
Can I have zoom in? Because I feel like it's a bit of a zoom in. Don't look at me like that. It's just this, it's richer, you know, it's going in.
Okay, you can have your two words. Yeah, that's fine. There's a high.
I'm going to go with four. Four.
I'm going revelatory. Mischievous.
Ooh. Great. Licker and Luke, when we last saw Pollen, things were tense. Can we forgive Colin? Can we forgive Colin?
No, and the season ends after one episode. She's like, I never forgive you. End titles. I think we have to, surely. Yeah.
I think it gives us a really good place to start. Like, if everything was all, you know, good between the two,
yeah,
it's like there's less growth for the two of them to go.
Yeah, and also she had him on this pedestal, so he had to be knocked off in order for him to, like, see him as a human being, which he is. A lovely human being,
start
but a human being nonetheless.
Start on an even playing field, and then we can go from there.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay. Both Penelope and Colin have transformed in season three. As actors, how did you approach that transformation and how do we see both Penn and Colin grow up this season?
I think, like, what was really fun to play the romantic leads of this year was that you've seen these characters for 3 years. So to see them play, us play different versions of Colin and Penn from season one, like, they felt like children.
Yeah, it feels
when we
so
look
different.
Back at pictures now, yeah.
It's weird for us. We say all the time that the last thing the fans have really seen is season two because it feels like a really different show. And it's interesting because they get these glow-ups aesthetically, but then you realize that there's still these big nerds underneath that, and they try and be all cool. You're like, you're not cool. You're not cool at all.
We all love Colin, but rumor around the town is that Penelope has some options, as she should. Queen. Tell us a bit about that.
Well, yes, she does.
She's decided. She's like going to find a husband. She heads back to the town and she's like, I got to get away from the Featheringtons. They're like wrecking my buzz. I'm out of here. So she basically is like, I'm going to find a husband. And Colin's like, I'll help you. She's like, fine. I don't love you at all. This will work out great with no problems. So she finds some suitors, some more successful than others, but one is very, very fond of her. And she's like, yeah, this could work.
My biggest threat.
I know. Yeah. I know, I was going to say something.
Don't say too much.
Like, spoilers.
Yeah. Claudia. Hello. Yeah. It's me and you. Last season also ended with some serious tension brewing between Penelope and her former bestie, Eloise. Claudia, where does season three pick up with Penn and Eloise? Penelope's, if you will.
Yeah. Well, they didn't make up off camera.
That'd be amazing.
But you're
like, in real life, we have to fight as well to make it real.
Whole 6 months. I think the level of the betrayal, I suppose, is quite large. So I don't think it's going to be made up quickly. However, it's probably quite good. They're so young. I always try and remind myself how young they are. And you know, Eloise comes from a really comfortable place, a really comfortable background, a very nurturing environment. And this is a big blow and the first of, you know, like, especially with a friendship at that age, so huge. So there's still a lot there. I'd love to say that we start episode one, we're like, back together. But they're not.
Human.
She's human. She's human. But it's probably good fuel, I think. It's probably good fuel.
I think it's kind of the second love story of the season. Yeah. And it's one of my favorite things to watch.
Yes. Eloise seems to have decided to embrace some of the Ton's traditions and expectations this season. What challenges did this put forward for her?
It goes against every part of her nature. It goes against everything. But I suppose what's good about Eloise is she's sort of stubborn. She's almost in spite of herself. There she is. in spite of herself. And I guess it's a great opportunity for her to almost, in Eloise's way, be like, well, let's see what everybody's cracking on with. Let's see what they're all banging on about. They seem to be doing this every year with no problem. So I think it's a good opportunity to see Eloise do something like this, but still within Eloise's way. It's funny, if anything. I hope you think that anyway. Thank you. They will. Thank you.
The Bridgerton bond is very tight. You can see that best in Eloise's protective nature. Of Colin. How do we see that highlighted this season?
I suppose the Bridgertons, they're such a beautiful bond they all have. It's so nice to see them together. We love doing those scenes together as well when we're all together. But they're protective at the best of times. But I think this is such a huge thing. This has been such a big thing for Colin as well, with all the things that have been revealed in Whistledown. I think Eloise has still got the, you know, a love for Penelope and this huge thing. It's the rock and a hard place is it. But it was great for us to have those so many scenes that we got to do together as well. Yeah. We loved being on set with each other.
We had so many.
I did.
Yeah.
I loved it.
Hated every minute of it.
Yeah.
No, we loved it. It was great.
It was nice for us to be together again.
It's like a real, it's not like a romantic love triangle, but there's a triangle
going
on here.
Yeah, there's
like
a lot going on.
Eloise.
The two loves of her life.
Ultimate third wheel. Eloise. <Yeah. laughs> Thank you.
Luke T, I'm coming to you.
God, I thought I was safe on the back row. You're gunning us down.
Because Eloise isn't the only Bridgerton sibling who's facing new challenges this season. While Colin has come back from his travels, a changed man, Benedict is still struggling to find his footing and a real sense of what he wants in life. Luke, where do we pick up with Benedict this season?
Well, as we know from the end of season two, he's sort of given up on the painting thing for a bit, or certainly put it aside. I mean, we sort of open with him sort of taking on the responsibilities that Anthony used to have and doing it quite well. And I think that's the problem with Benedict, is that actually I think he can step into quite a few different roles and sort of happily do that. But there's always this question at the centre, which is, but who's he and what does he want and where does he fit in? And I think there's a nice freedom to that, obviously, but also with freedom comes a sort of slight sense of loneliness, maybe, you know, just sort of sense of, well, actually, it's nice to have the choice to do anything and to sort of float about. And but you get a sense more and more, I think, hopefully, if I've done my job properly, that actually, you know, that it's a bit of a dilemma, really, freedom. And like having the freedom to do lots of things, like it can be a bit paralyzing, or it can sort of complicate your sense of who you are and what you actually want. Yeah. If you can step into lots of different things, you know.
You mentioned Benedict having to take on some of the responsibilities of Anthony. How do we see Benedict evolve this season?
Just dancing on eggshells.
I know. I'm thinking.
No, I mean, I think, you know, he's a bit of a free spirit, so he's still sort of, you know, he's passionate and impulsive, and he's sort of still working himself out, you know. So I think it's still very much that's always been his trajectory. I guess it sort of gets, all I can say maybe is that it comes to a head, as in a little bit, you know, like he has to really sort of start I guess he confront. He eventually sort of confronts. You know, it's a confronting thing. You know,
well
like,
said.
As in, I think like the pressure that's been cooking on him since season one is sort of like getting. You know,
absolutely.
Basically, I think he's saying spoilers.
Yeah. No spoilers by any means necessary.
It's not that I'm really inarticulate. It's the spoilers.
Really difficult with this job to not do spoilers. My last question for you is, do you think Benedict wants to settle down or go on some sort of big journey to find himself like Colin?
Well,
spoilers.
The problem
I'm sorry.
No. The problem is that I feel like Benedict's always got sort of he's always slightly spectating on himself, I think. As in like the fact that Colin can't go away without Benedict being like, oh, you're all right, what's going on with you? Why are you going away and like having fun? What's that about? Like, I feel like there's nothing that he doesn't step back and is commenting on, which is, you know, why he himself hasn't quite found himself yet, is that I think he's always sort of slightly on the outside. So the complicated answer is that he probably doesn't know what he wants. He probably wants a bit of both, but the problem is because whichever one he wants, he can't take it seriously, because if he settles down, he'll be, you know, there'll be a part of him be like, oh, what are you doing the settling down thing, are you? Or, you know, vice versa. If he's, you know, there's always just that thing, that sort of slightly theatrical sense, I guess, in a weird way. Yeah.
Absolutely. Martins.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes. All right. How's everyone doing? Everyone all right? Yeah.
It's not only Penelope and Colin who step out of the shadows this season. Will has also become a staple and confidant of the ton through his bar, but things are about to change for him. Can you preview what's in store for Will and his family this season?
Hey, no spoilers. But Will and Alice are literally drawn out of the shadows. And they inherit a whole new title, which none of us saw coming. So it's, how do we navigate this new title, this new position? How does it impact the family dynamics? And there's a lot to navigate, especially like being integrated into the ton and what that means. And so it's a whole new challenge. Yeah.
His rise into the upper ranks of the ton comes as a shock, and one that most might naturally think would be amazing for him, but there seems to be some trade-offs to being part of the ton. Can you speak to his inner conflict?
Yeah, Will's very stubborn. He's very, very stubborn. He loves his bar, and I feel like he doesn't want to conform to societal expectations. So it's, how do you find the balance between attending all these events and actually, but not giving up who you are or your sense of self at the same time? So there's a lot of integrity to Will, which I feel like he's kind of trying to navigate and understand and also protect his family. So, yeah.
Now, fans were able to spend some time in between seasons with the following two favourites in Queen Charlotte, A Bridgerton Story. Everyone say hello to Golda, our favourite queen, and Adjoa. Hello.
Hello.
So we were so excited to see more of your backstory in the limited series. But there were also present day scenes that gave more of a glimpse into the lives of your characters. Can you tell us where we pick up with both of them in season three?
I think for Lady Agatha Danbury, what's been lovely for season three is to just get, once you know a little bit of her history, to get an understanding of why she's so invested in the Bridgerton family. I found it incredibly touching to look at this woman and to understand the depth of her relationships with Golda's Queen Charlotte, who when we meet them as young women embarking on this journey in this new world, with her relationship with Violet Bridgerton, you know, to understand that she can be this older woman, but she still carries this huge, life-changing love for Lord Ledger, and it informs every fibre of her being and the way she moves forward in the world. And also you sort of see in those early stages with these younger women, the way they have to navigate this new arena, how they protect themselves, how they strategize, how they form alliances, who they avoid, who they lean towards. And so when you see, you know, G will speak for herself, but when you see Lady Danbury as an older woman operating in the ton, you understand why she's an operator. Because how do you survive in this, frankly, hostile environment if you don't understand the navigations that must be made, and you see in Queen Charlotte her negotiations with George's mother. She uses knowledge as her superpower. You know, the knowledge she has is the way that she protects herself, she protects her children, she protects their future, and she begins to understand the structures of the world that she's in. And at the same time, she carries this enormous love. And the love for the people that she loves. And she recognises in the young queen someone who's also going to have to learn to navigate this new environment. And it's, you know, how do you make alliances? You see someone, you recognise, oh, okay, we have similar journeys to make here. How do we make alliances? How do we navigate? How do we support each other? When do we step back? When do we come forward? All of that stuff. Mm-hmm. So I felt like Queen Charlotte, for me, just enriched Lady Danbury when we came into season three.
Absolutely. What she said. And also, what I think is really beautiful and I carry in my heart is that the fans have now caught up. Do you know what I mean? You know, Adjoa and I, when we first started Bridgerton, we did all the work, we did all the research, we did character in depth. You know, I knew about my children, but the audience didn't. And Shonda wrote those kids so beautifully and so complex that now the audience understands Charlotte as a family woman. You know, I always kind of described Queen Charlotte as behind the scenes. You know, from Bridgerton, Queen Charlotte would walk out of one room and go into the room of Queen Charlotte of Bridgerton's story. They're all connected. And now the fans have caught up with the three characters that they know and love so well from Bridgerton. So that feels to me like a beautiful support going into Bridgerton number three. You know, the fans are with us. You know, and they're rooting for us and they understand us. They understand the complexities of the relationships that, you know, have been formed and they have seen in Queen Charlotte.
Just to add, shut up, Adjoa. Just to add, no, just that thing about relationships, long loves, yeah. How the loves that you have will change over the years. And how do you navigate that?
The history of the relationships.
How do you navigate difficulty and grief and loss? How do you stay in a relationship when it's hard? Or, you know, all those.
Also, I think the kind of intimacy, you know, when you are with in a situation where everything is public. Mm. Do you know what I mean? The intimacy. How do you do private?
Yeah.
You know, and I think that was lovely to see as well within Queen Charlotte, that the privacy that these
and the vulnerability,
three, and the vulnerability that these women have with each other. And I love the Brimsley and Queen Charlotte story as well.
Yes,
absolutely.
That was, you know, thank you. I'll tell Hugh.
Tell Hugh.
I'll tell Hugh. You know, right from the beginning, Hugh and I were like, we're going to be the big best double act ever. You know, and now we have it. So that's, thank you, Shonda.
Love it. I'm glad you spoke about relationships and you've spoken about each of your characters individually. We obviously saw the friendship between these two. It was built in Queen Charlotte. In the years since, how would you say that friendship has changed and evolved?
Well, you know, we're also living our individual lives at the same time. So, you know, as G was saying, there's the private world of these women as well. But, you know, the court continues and you have to stay
public
constantly afloat.
Continues.
So, and that flotation is a support ecosystem that they have between them. And the years of experience that brings, and the, you know, when you've had an, you know, I have friends that I was at school with, you've got a sort of shorthand. And you've got jokes that you have. And also, there's something about you see that person as you first saw them. They never change.
We grew up together.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? I think that's
And it's magical and it's really precious.
That's the connection. That's the line, you know, from belly button to belly button, is that we were all children, you know, youngsters, and we grew up in this world trying to, as Aj says, the navigation of it all. And also to understand the status. You know, there is a play on status with the three of them out in public, but there is not in private, you know, and to find that and to really relish that friendship, I think was really important to see.
Absolutely. Gold and it's also women all together, which is always fabulous.
Which is always great. Golda, what does it take to catch the Queen's eye as a diamond of the season? Does she ever get tired of wedding season?
Yes. And I think what's really lovely with Jess's ignition into B3 is that there's a kind of, Nicola touched on it lightly, there's a newness to it. So we find Queen Charlotte a little bit bored of what has gone on before and searching for something different. Like, where are they? You know, she's a little bit bored of the women that are curtsying, the girls that are curtsying in front of her. You know, it's like, what? Where is it? You know, and I think Jess being new to us, and I think it's really amazing that that is kind of part of the show as well. And, yeah, I can't wait for you to see what she has done.
Adwa, Lady Danbury is a trusted advisor and confidant in the Ton. This season, she seems to go on a personal journey of her own. Can you speak about that?
Can I? Yes, I mean, she's got a carefully constructed persona, dynamic, place. She knows that she's like a sole operator of a company. She knows how to do things and where they go. And then suddenly, out of left field, the company is going to be a bit shook. And she has to work out how to navigate that, you know, with the arrival that happens. It's like, are they going to knock me off my game? Are they going to put cracks in my carefully constructed facade? How do I navigate a new energy in the space? Can I control it? Do I want to push it to one side? Is it going to mess up my relationships with long-established, hard-won, beloved relationships? Is it going to mess with that? And so you sort of see Lady Danbury on the back foot slightly, I think, and being on the back foot, slightly not in control of her emotions, which is fabulous to play.
Ooh, yes.
You know, and Jess has given me all that space to sort of have a little wobble here and there and a little flare there, which is really great. So, yeah.
You both are intimately involved in wedding season, and it seems we have some news of a real Bridgerton wedding season being upon us. Is that true?
Oh, well now. Yes, yes, we do indeed.
Here we
have a special announcement today.
Drum rolls, please. Thank you.
It's going to be the talk of the ton.
So Bridgerton is about love.
Yes, it is.
And we wouldn't be here without the love of our fans.
Mm-hmm.
So, ladies and gentlemen and people of the world, Netflix wants to thank and celebrate the love. And they are throwing a real-life Bridgerton wedding for a lucky couple.
Woo! You heard it here first. And
real
of course,
life.
We want to involve everybody who wants to be involved every step of the way.
Yes.
And as we know, planning a ball, a celebration, a fabulous, spectacular event is no small feat. So we will be sharing, G and Adjua will be sharing.
Well, there will be some other people there
I think
as well.
So too.
Just you two at the wedding.
Hopefully a lovely
we'll
couple.
We'll be sewing the drapes. No, we will be sharing our tips and our inspiration for how you make a Regency spectacular and weave it into your special day's celebrations.
Yes. What? What if we want to get married? I'm already married, babe.
You're
so
already married.
I so can't, am I. There'd be trouble.
There'd be real
again.
Trouble.
Get married again. Do a vow renewal.
Ooh, double weddings. Not to mention, I hear quite a few Bridgerton cast members. I've said that bit, so
They may well be in attendance.
We're trying to riff. We're trying to read. We're trying to. Yeah, lucky fans have been selected to walk down the aisle. Hurrah!
Excellent. Excellent. Yeah.
You can have a look at socials. You know, later on weeks and stuff, they'll all be announced there for you.
Very excited for the Bridgerton wedding. I would love my invite in the post. I'll let you know what my address is. So, going back to the top of the panel, Nicola, you were mentioning a suitor for Penelope. We just wanted to give a sneak peek of who that is to the fans.
Oh, why don't we? Yeah. We're, I feel like, should I do magic? Be like, Alakazam, there he is. Is that going to work? Is he going to be there on the screen? Yay!
There we go.
Lord Debling, or Debbers, as we like to call him.
Yeah.
Excellent. Rival lover, love that. Before everyone leaves, we have a few questions from fans in the audience. So, firstly, we have a question for Jess. The series has maintained a balance between romance and intrigue. How did you plan and execute the plot of the third season to keep the audience intrigued without losing the romantic touch that characterizes Bridgerton?
Well, great source material. I think Julia's, you know, really a master of big emotional swings that really land. So we look to that. I also, something I've really learned from Shonda is not to just write what you think should happen, but write what you want to see and what you're excited about. We spend the first day in the room blue skying, talking about what images, what events, what scenes from the book do we want to see, and we let that guide us. I also think that love and friendship and romance and family, these are things that naturally have a lot of weight in our lives, but they don't always get the proper weight on television. And so it's just giving them their space to breathe and intrigue.
Shonda, as Bridgerton continues to captivate audiences, what's one important message or impact you hope the show leaves on viewers beyond entertainment?
Wow. I mean, I think for me, one of the things that I always found exciting about the way the show is written and what we're portraying in Julia's books is that we're finding a way to give these female characters agency in a world in which they very, very rarely have any. You know, the marriage mart is a hard, unpleasant place, and we are watching these women again and again find their way through it, watching the characters find their way through it so that they're really focused on their own dreams and their own hopes. And I love that for Penelope's character. It's amazing.
And you guys nailed it with the writing of the season. You just got it so right. When Jess sat Luke and I down and told us the story, we were like, no! And what happens next in the next one? Like, so much happens in this season. Yeah. It's wild.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of brilliant storytelling that you brought that I think enhances even the greatness of the books.
This one's for you.
Oh, yeah.
How was it to become Queen Charlotte again after the Queen Charlotte series? You have more insight about her past and the reason she became the woman she is now. Do you think it helped you inhabit her more, or maybe it made it more difficult?
I think it's definitely more inhabitable. And I think it, just touching back on what I was saying about knowing that the fans are with us now, you know, that gives, that makes me excited to move forward into Bridgerton 3, because I know there's a whole world that is coming with me.
Okay, this is a question for all of you. How has the Bridgerton series changed your life? This is a big question. And obviously you've got the people who are looking right here, so you better say something nice. Martins, I'll start with you.
Me?
Yeah.
How has it changed my life? huge, it's such a huge question, but changed my life in many ways. I would say it's given me a lot more hope in productions, you know, hope in storytelling. You know, it feels like I show up to work and I feel proud to invest in this story or invest in this world. So that's amazing. And this was my first TV job, so to be a part of something, so... Yeah.
Everyone else's answer is going to be rubbish after that. We're going to be like, oh, I don't know.
Yeah. So as an artist, it's really just given me a lot of hope and integrity and, yeah, and pride, which is great. So I'll say that.
It's cured my fear of cameras.
Excellent. Claudia, what about you?
Like, as an actor, you don't come away from every single job being like, I loved every single second of that. I loved it. I feel spiritually aligned with 100% of that. You don't always, that doesn't always happen. But I think what I really respect about Shonda and obviously Jess and the whole team is that this is TV made for everyone. A lot of times you can come away from TV being like, that was either made for everyone else that's already in the industry or no one that was on screen. So this is what I'm most proud of and how it's changed my life is that I can confidently say there's not one bit of this job that I don't feel completely and utterly proud of. So that's what I think. Also, it makes up for a minute ago when I sounded really stupid because I'm trying to stay away from spoilers. So I didn't want people to be like, she's not very smart. So thank you.
Andrew, what about yourself?
So I was in Ghana last week and my dad's from, and this car suddenly screeched in the middle of the street. The driver just left the car in the street and she ran across. She grabbed me, burst into tears and just said, ah, Bridgerton, what you are doing for us? Oh. She meant it as an African, she meant it as a woman, and she meant it as an older woman as well. And I just think, you know, I have a huge friendship group, and I have children of all ages, and parents still, thank God. And I just, I think this show makes a space for everybody. And I find it incredibly moving, and especially... you know, that we launched during the pandemic when everybody was isolated, lonely, frightened about their future, feeling out of control. And this show just extended its arms to everyone and said, come on in, you're welcome. Come sit with us for a while.
You said something brilliant the other day after the screening that killed me. We watched the first two episodes as a group and you turned to me after it screened. I don't want to cry now, you might make me cry. But you turned to me and said, this is for the wallflowers.
I was a wallflower and season three is for all us wallflowers. Yeah. So yeah, so it's an amazing show, and I'm, as Claude said, I'm really, really thrilled and proud, and slightly baffled that I'm a part of it. Yeah.
Lovely. Really nice. I'm gonna cry. What about yourself, Golda?
I can't buy pants in Marks and Spencer's anymore. Without being asked for a photograph.
Your pants.
So, holding the pants of Marks and Spencer's. So, and people sidling up to me when I'm buying a shower cap and saying, are you, so that's, yes. That's how it's changed my life.
Excellent. Two different ends of the spectrum there.
Hey, like, I keep it real, babes. Great. I keep it real.
Absolutely. Oh, God. Luke, what about you?
For me, I feel like it's been a real treat to have, like, some sort of consistency on a job. I feel like as actors, you're constantly moving on to the next thing and the next thing and the next thing. And sometimes they're really short-lived and sometimes you don't get to play that character's story out as long as you'd really like to. So it's been a real treat to be able to work on these characters and then portray them and you sort of lead the show this year and get their full romance story come to life. It's been a real...
We're so silly though, because we look back at pictures of season one, in which in real life we were full adults.
Yeah.
We were like, oh my God, we were so babies. Young. We were so tiny. We were only 5 and 4. Yeah. Like, it's so dumb. Even though we know we were literally there. But yeah, but it feels like we send each other like fan edits. So
yeah.
Am I just making this look really uncool now?
We actually took some pictures this year that were the same as the pictures we took on season one.
Yeah.
Just to see, like, there's a little picture in a mirror
with a candlestick, and we recreated it. It was actually really hard to do.
Yeah.
We needed one of the grips. We were like, can you move the candle and help?
Yeah. How does it work? Yeah. It was great. But then also just like, it feels, being a part of this production, this team feels really collaborative, and like working with Jess this year, like we had a group chat and we really got to like dive in deep on what we wanted to portray here and how we wanted the whole show to
play. You were amazing, Jess, and you were so open as well to like, we would see sometimes things on social media of things that the fans would really want, and you were so open to that, whereas another show writer might have been like, leave me alone, like, don't. But you were amazing in that way. And then also with your beautiful books, like, we knew there were certain things that the fans really wanted, and we would say back to you, like, could this be in? And you were amazing with that, which is a real privilege and not common at all. It was amazing.
We were nervous for the days when there was a moment from the books.
Massively.
Right? There were days that we were like, wow.
Well, it's like stuff that we read in season one. You're like, oh my God, there's a carriage scene. Ha ha. Then since you're like, oh wow, okay, it's on the okay, that's happening.
Yeah, no, it's great. Yeah,
I think there's an Easter egg in almost every episode of
sure
a line
is, yeah.
from the book for fans to look for. You noticed it when you read. Yeah.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Big nerd.
And for me, seeing the Easter eggs was really fun too. But occasionally, I'd say, that's really familiar. Did I write that? Because for me, I wrote the book so long ago, and I like, there's one line in particular that you say, I can't say what it is, but I remember being like, I think I wrote that.
You're like, I'm pretty good, actually.
Yeah.
Were you like, what beautiful writing? And then, wow, oh, I wrote
that's
that.
A good line. I literally went back into my manuscript and did like a search for that line, being like, wow, did I write that?
Did you?
I did. Although I have to say that after Queen Charlotte came out, people would come up to me and say, how dare you? And I would kept having to say, if it's the part that made you cry, that was Shonda. Oh.
That's amazing. Nicola, how has the Bridgerton series changed your life?
I think before Bridgerton, had I gone to Brazil, I could have just hopped around. I think now, hey, oi Brazil. I know, I think that's probably not the case. I've never felt more like Beyonce. They were like, we have security, we have this, you have a car. I was like, oh my God, I'm so fancy. And then I get back to London again, I'm trying to buy pants and M&S. I'm like, oh yeah, that's not my life. That's only in Brazil.
Judy, what about yourself?
Well, I'm not nearly as visible, so I could probably go to Marks and Spencer and buy pants and I'd be fine. Oh yay. I just feel like I'm living a Cinderella story still. I mean, the fact that I'm sitting here with you guys is amazing. You know, I was telling somebody the fact, like, I'm taking a 2-day trip to London. I never thought I'd be the person who'd take a 2-day trip to London, yet here I am. It's just a dream. I mean, to be able to, with when you're a romance writer, even if you're quite successful, people outside romance have no idea who you are, and suddenly to be able to say what you do and have people actually recognize it is kind of fun. Be like, you know, oh, I'm a writer. Oh, are you published? Well, have you heard of a show called Bridgerton? And they'd say yes. Well, I wrote the books, and it's amazing. And just to see not just my words, but my genre finally up on the screen. Because it's not something that really had ever been done before. And we had never tried to shop it around because nobody was buying it. And then
that Shonda Rhimes, she's clever.
She knows what she's about. But I don't think it's a surprise that you were the person to actually see the potential in this particular genre, not necessarily my books, but just in a genre that is so focused on women and on relationships. Again, it just wasn't something we were seeing on television in this manner. I will say all my fans were very worried that she was going to kill somebody off. And I said, don't worry. She knows it isn't Grey's. We're good.
Now everybody in the back row and the two people are worried for their jobs.
This is romance. We have happy endings.
Jess, what about yourself?
Well, physically, I moved to London, so my life changed quite a lot. But I think also writing this particular season, there are a lot of themes about embracing who you really are and standing up for who you are, who you love, and what you love. And I think that message has really resonated with me quite a lot.
Shonda, what about yourself?
You know, oddly, I've done a lot of shows, but oddly, this was the biggest swing that I've ever tried to make with a show, to really read some books, fall in love with them, and then try to help do them justice by bringing them to the screen. It was a big deal for me because I really wanted to get it right. And when it premiered and people had this reaction to these wonderful actors and these wonderful scripts, it was so gratifying to me because I didn't know how it was going to be taken. I knew I wanted to see these love stories on screen, but I wasn't sure that everybody else did with us. And so it was great to have the audience like be there and be excited about it.
Jess, another question for you. With the constant evolution of the plot and characters in Bridgerton, how did you approach the challenge of maintaining freshness and originality in the third season, both in terms of writing and performance?
You know, third season, sometimes shows fall into a slump. I think we're quite lucky because we have a different couple we focus on every year. It means the show is naturally reinventing itself. So we didn't worry about it too much. I did want to make sure we were constantly raising the bar on the visuals because I know people have come to expect that. And everyone from the writing staff to our hair and makeup teams, our costume teams, VFX, they are bringing it this season. And the show is even brighter and more spectacular than ever.
Okay, I have some rapid fire questions for you all. Okay. Who is most like their character on screen?
Luke Newton.
Probably me.
You're like, I'm just a little cutie.
Yeah. I think he's a nice guy, easy to relate to, so yeah.
I'm not like you.
I'm kidding!
Is that a general consensus? Anybody else?
He's just such a nice guy, yeah.
Yeah, he is.
Charming. Go on, list a few, everyone, please.
Everyone actually.
Self-effacing.
And then on the opposite, who is least like their on-screen character?
Golda, I think.
You think so?
Yeah, she's so down to earth. Oh,
well,
come on.
Martins, me and you, dear.
Yeah. Golda, would you agree with that?
I would agree with
okay,
that, yes.
Fine. That's good.
Buying her pants in M&S, babe. She's well down
to earth. You're so right. Okay, who has the most bloopers?
You mean Johnny?
Johnny Bailey, yeah.
Yeah.
Or Claudia.
You know your lines. That's not what we're saying.
No, it was
me. I learned my lines.
Yeah. No, not that. But you will. I mean, you cannot say
Ruth
as
well.
Panel.
Is quite bloopery, isn't she?
We'll call Cut, and she'll say something wrong, and she'll say,
"Oh, I'll
something
say something
me up to something." Yeah. As much as I can.
I'm probably the most prone to. I'm ever so sorry. You guys have to watch this all the time. Profanities. I'm the most. Yeah.
But you've never fluffed a line. I've never seen you fluff a line.
You
ever.
Are the queen of rapid fire delivery, Claude.
Yeah, you are. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Thank you. You heard it here.
Everybody clap.
Shonda and Jess, are there any other cast characters in this series that we haven't touched upon that you want to tee up for fans?
Spoilers.
We have a lot of really exciting characters joining us this year. A lot of new faces. I think it's worth talking about the Featheringtons, don't you think?
Yeah.
You know, in every family, people have their roles. And when people step out of those roles, it can throw a family into chaos. And there they are. Penn is definitely stepping out of her role this year. stepping out of her citrus colors. What that will do to Lady Featherington, who was sure citrus was the best color palette. Drama, you know? Absolute drama.
And what it does to the sisters.
Yeah.
It's very, I love that story, actually. I think it's very moving. It's hilarious, but then it's very moving.
A lot of hijinks.
So this is my final question to all. What do you hope audiences will enjoy and take away from this series? I'll start with the cast. Luke, I'll go with you. Yeah, please.
I feel like everyone's going to have a really great answer, so I'll keep mine really brief at this point. I just think it's really nice to explore another relationship. I think it's one of the most amazing things about the show is that each year we, like Jess said, we focus on a new couple. So each year it's a brand new story and we get to see, we really dive into their relationship and their growth. And I think it just means that each year people will relate to a different story. If you related to characters in season one, the two leads from that, you might relate to people in season two. And then again, for their storyline, the sort of friends to lovers, I feel like a lot of people will resonate with that, so I'm excited to share that with everyone.
I agree. I think this season is so really hope that it can make people feel seen and make everyone know how deserving they are of love. And I think a lot of us, it doesn't matter who you are, we can be down on ourselves. And I think, I hope this helps you celebrate who you are and love yourself.
Is my mic on? I said such a beautiful thing.
You did.
No, sorry. Oh, sorry, guys. Hello, everybody. Oh, sorry. Oh, I was keeping both of them. No, sorry. There. Thank you. All right. Sorry about that. So I think, for this season, it was from watching it the other day. I didn't expect it to be as emotional as it was. The scripts were phenomenal. The story is so brilliant. I think we really wanted to do it justice, but I hope this season will make people who feel not seen, seen, and make everyone realize how deserving and worthy they are of love.
I'm going to go to the back to finish the cast. Golda, what about yourself? What do you hope audiences will enjoy and take away from this series?
I think it, you know, what Luke said about the every season we have a new couple to focus on. But this year we have a new showrunner that's focusing on that new couple. So the injection of Jess's brilliance and storytelling, I think will elevate the Bridgerton world even further.
Adra, what about yourself?
This season is, it makes you laugh, and while you're laughing, you're suddenly crying. It does that to you. It kind of throws you around. And as a viewer, I love that when that happens. But you know what Nick said about the wallflower thing? Yeah, this, you know, up it for the wallflowers. Yay, yay.
Claudia, what about yourself?
Thank you. I think, yeah, what's lovely about the show is that it's a reminder that people falter, people make mistakes, people fall over, people develop, people maybe feel like they're going backwards, and that, like, it's not a new, like, thing. And that's why it's good, because it's a reminder that we all do that as human beings. And it's just a really beautiful way of seeing that. Of course, it's a really gorgeous show, but just a reminder. I love that. And that also, one other thing, is that it is okay to just really love something. And this show is what I think is just, it's really okay to just love it with your whole heart.
Yeah.
Like, it makes it feel so easy to do that. But yeah, those are the things, I think.
Lovely. Luke, what about yourself?
I'd say just a holiday. But I think, like, I sort of think of the show with every season it comes out, it is like a holiday, and like a holiday, you sort of enjoy it. You're in this sort of world of fantasy, and then you come back a little revived and a little hopeful and a little warmer for it. And yeah, I just think that the same thing happens again. I think that's what I'd hope. Yeah.
What about yourself, Martins?
I think the show is so relatable. I think it really bridges the gap between a period drama and today. So I think people can really see themselves in these characters. So I hope people just, I don't know, see the characters, love them, but also ask themselves the right questions. Or I hope it's a guide for people to, I don't know, investigate their, you know, how they might feel in terms of their relationships, their love. And so, yeah, there's a lot to take from it. There's a lot to take from it.
Julia, Jess, Shonda, is there anything you want to add about what you hope audiences will enjoy and take away from this series?
I really like Luke's answer a lot, just about the holiday. I mean, that's what I hear from people when they find out I'm involved. You know, and they say, oh my gosh, it was just so wonderful. It was an escape. It just made me happy. And I love that you could have a show that people have to just make them happy, but still makes you think. It's not, you know, without depth. But it still is something that just leaves you happy in the end. And I think we need more of that. We need more elevation of happiness as a worthy goal in life and as something that is worth art, you know?
Yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah.
I think that's just...
Very much. I'm trying to think of a way to say differently what everyone has said so eloquently. I mean, I think for me, one way to talk about the theme of the season is find your light. And your light might be a flush mount overhead light. Your light might be a giant spotlight. Your light might be a weird little neon pen light. Whatever your light is, find it, because it wants to find you. So that's a takeaway.
That's lovely. Anything to add, Shonda?
I think I'm going to echo a little bit of what Adwa said, because I really do think this is for the wallflowers. But I also think there's a line that Lady Danbury says in Queen Charlotte, where she says, we are untold stories. And I feel like this season really leans into the idea of telling those untold stories. You get to see a little bit of what's going on emotionally with the more adult ladies in the show. And I think that that's very exciting. So it sort of brings everybody into this world even more.
We're very excited for the new season, very excited for more untold stories. Well done, everyone. I think you've done a great job at not doing any spoilers, just saying. I know it's tough. I know what it's like. You did great. You really did great. All right, everybody on the live stream, it's been awesome. Be sure to share your event photos, reactions using hashtag Bridgerton and tag at Bridgerton Netflix and at Shondaland. You are all about to be the very first to see the first 2 minutes of season 3. That's the reaction that I want to hear. Yeah. But before we play it, please let's thank our amazing cast and executive producer Shonda Rhimes, showrunner Jess Darnell, and author Julia Quinn for joining us. Thank you so much. Okay, here it is, the opening of Bridgerton season 3.
Good night, Mr. Bridgerton.
Do you not need a chaperone?
Spinsters do not need chaperones.
You are not a spinster.
I am in my third year on the marriage market with no prospects to show for it. What would you call that?
Something wrong? Penny, between us, I mean. I wrote to you this summer, as I always do, and, well, you did not respond. Admittedly, very few did, but if you are going to make me say it out loud, I miss you.
You miss me. You miss me, but you had never caught me, is that correct?
Pen,
I overheard you at my mama's ball last season, telling everyone how you would never, ever court Penelope Featherington. Yes, I quite
agree. Perhaps we should talk about this somewhere more private.
Because I embarrass you. Of course you would never court me. I am the laughingstock of the town, even when I change my entire wardrobe. It just never occurred to me that you, of all people, could be so cruel.